We were promised it would be the planet-saving fuel of the future, but now your diesel car could be about to cost you a whole lot more.
Millions of people were told that they were doing the right thing by buying a diesel vehicle, and they now feel very, very hacked off.
Why you're unlikely to match the fuel economy figures they boast about in the showroom?
On average, the MPG in real driving is 22% below.
How diesel fumes are damaging our children's health.
My baby in his buggy is inhaling that level of pollution.
We ask, have all of us who drive a diesel been duped?
I think people have been conned to some extent.
And when it comes to diesel, the politicians admit they messed up.
The decision that we took was the wrong decision.
Years ago, these were the sorts of vehicles that ran on diesel. Your white van, your 4x4, and something that looks more at home in a farmer's field than it does in the fast lane. Then millions of us went out and bought a diesel-powered family car. Last year, more of us bought diesel than petrol. And some of them these days look a lot more fancy than that lot.
Better economy, lower emissions, and a higher price come part exchange. No wonder 10 million of us now drive a diesel. Here's one of those converts. Susie spends most of her time ferrying her young family between school, nursery, and the supermarket.
Right, come on, let's go, let's go.
She needed a car big enough to do the job. A seven-seater Seat Alhambra diesel.
So what do you think of your car, Susie?
I love it. Just the size of it, when you've got three such small children, it's a great size car, and it's got quite a few nifty features that make it a really good family car.
And why did you particularly go for diesel?
I went for diesel because I know it's a big car and I know it was going to drink a lot of fuel, and I thought diesel was probably going to be the most efficient.
Emissions are really important to Susie too. Her daughter has a lung condition.
Is the environment something that you consider?
Yeah, it is really important. You know, I've got three very small children and they're going to grow up in this world, and I try and do as much as I can that's good. And I know that driving a big seven-seat car isn't the most ideal thing, but unfortunately, I can't drive an electric car at the moment because I need as much space as I can get.
And that eco badge on the back of the car, was that a selling point?
Yes, it was, because, you know, the environment is important to me, so seeing the Ecomotive did kind of ease my conscience.
So what drove this shift towards diesel? Well, back in the 90s, the world was worried about global warming. The race was on to cut carbon emissions. Diesels produce less carbon dioxide than petrol. Chancellor Gordon Brown knew how to get us to switch fuels. Cheaper car tax for vehicles low on CO2.
The environmental impact of these tax cuts, taken together with the revenue-neutral proposal for company cars, will be a reduction in carbon emissions of 1 million tonnes by 2010, helping to meet the Kyoto targets.
Saving the planet and money? Who wouldn't sign up for that one? Diesel's new dawn had begun.
Oh, isn't it just bliss when a diesel goes like this?
In this innovative ad, cleaner, greener, quieter diesels are the future. Last year, more than half of all new cars sold were diesel. And yes, because they do more miles to the gallon, they produce less carbon dioxide. But what about all the other nasties coming out of your exhaust? Well, compared to petrol, diesels produce 22 times the amount of soot, called particulate matter, a cause of cancer, and four times the oxides of nitrogen, with nitrogen dioxide the biggest worry for our health, damaging lungs and blood vessels, and a cause of heart disease, stroke, and diabetes. And yet the government at the time encouraged us to junk petrol for diesel. Maybe they weren't aware of those other pollutants. Not so, according to Roy Harrison, who warned ministers about the dangers more than 20 years ago.
You wrote specifically about your concerns about diesel engines in 1993.
Well, I chaired an advisory committee in 1993 that was advising the government on urban air quality issues, and we recognised that there might be future problems associated with the increasing uptake of diesel passenger cars.
A Labour environment spokesman now admits his party got it badly wrong.
You were the ones that came up with the idea of linking CO2 to car tax. You drove the dash for diesel. You're the ones that have created all this, these terrible emissions in our cities.
Can I just say, there is absolutely no question that the decision that we took was the wrong decision. But, and it's a big but, at that time, we didn't have the evidence that subsequently we did have, and we had cleaner diesel engines, which we thought meant that any potential problem was a lower grade problem than the problem that we're trying to solve of CO2.
15 years ago, the EU introduced strict limits on all emissions for new cars. These get stricter every few years. This should mean less pollution. But in its latest air quality plan for the EU, our government admitted there is too much nitrogen dioxide in 38 out of 43 areas in the UK. So why aren't we seeing the expected improvements, especially as the manufacturers have to test their cars to ensure they meet EU emissions? We wanted to find out what happens when you replace European laboratory conditions with the real roads of Manchester. Time to trick up Susie's people carrier.
This is what we think of as our laboratory on the road. So we have what is the same technology you would get in the laboratory, packaged up very nicely so we can stick it on a car and then go and drive it with a real driver on real road to find out what this car really does in terms of emissions and fuel economy.
Kit like this measures real-world fuel consumption compared with the manufacturer's lab test results.
What difference have you noted between your real-world figures and the manufacturer's claimed numbers?
On average, the MPG in real driving is 22% below. That's on average across the 550 cars we've tested.
Of those 550, only 8 performed as well as the manufacturers claimed. How can that be?
The car makers have found dozens of ways of manipulating those test results so that the car passes the test but doesn't perform anything like as well on the road. Each of these small tweaks makes 1 to 2% difference in the fuel economy, but means there's an enormous gap between what the test results say and what a consumer will actually achieve on the road.
Tweaks? Well, according to some industry insiders, they can be a tiny bit more brutal than a mere tweak. If you have a passion for high mileage, old French saloons, look away now. This is a modern classic from the turn of the millennium, but I think I can make this hatchback even more fuel efficient and cut down on the emissions. First of all, it's time for the car to go on a diet and lose some weight. It's not clear what the manufacturers do to make the cars lighter.
Every little helps.
And we're definitely not saying Citroën does this, but according to campaigners, some manufacturers could
even remove the back seat.
We know a lighter car uses less fuel, so better emissions and economy.
Okay, weight saving done. Let's work on the aerodynamics.
According to a report for the EU, some manufacturers could go so far as to remove wing mirrors and tape up vents and gaps. The tests are also run at temperatures that optimise the car's performance. How do the manufacturers get away with testing a car when it may not be exactly the same as the one we drive on the road?
The procedures which the companies have to follow don't say you can't disconnect the battery and you can't tape up the doors and grills. Of course they don't, because that would be stupid. No one would drive a car like that.
In the UK, the Vehicle Certification Agency says manufacturers can take out optional parts, but the vehicle tested must include all standard components, including near-side wing mirrors, which are compulsory. They admit some manufacturers adjust cars specifically to improve performance for the test. This is not allowed. So what does the motor industry have to say for itself?
Do you manipulate the tests?
No, all the manufacturers operate within the set tests. And as I said, the test has to be witnessed by an independent third-party witness, which is appointed often by the government agency.
When you're dropping the kids off at school or you're going to the local supermarket, how often do you tape up the panel gaps? Because that's what's happening, apparently, in some of these tests. That's how manufacturers are behaving. And to us, it feels like we're being had, we're being hoodwinked.
I'm not aware of manufacturers who would basically seek to cheat the test.
But what about taping up the panel gaps? Is that cheating, Mike?
I don't think that would be necessarily cheating the test. I mean, it is about, as I said, having a repeatable test, and you have to ensure that that vehicle that is tested is taken from production and has to be, you know, fit for purpose.
The EU is about to introduce new testing standards to include real-world driving. The hope is they will bring down emissions further. And those emissions may be responsible for the deaths of tens of thousands of Britons. Professor Frank Kelly is a leading government scientist on the health effects of air pollution. He says particulate matter is lethal.
They are now linked with the early deaths of 29,000 people across the UK. And that's rather a substantial figure, because the only other figure which beats that is the one associated with active smoking.
Could the figure be higher than that if you factor in other emissions?
Undoubtedly so, yeah. Nitrogen oxide has got independent health effects to the particles. So heart disease, stroke, diabetes, these are all conditions which we never thought before we would be linking with something like the air we breathe.
Come on, lads. The Weber family noticed effects on their health when they moved to East London 8 years ago.
Hi, boys.
Last year, Shazia started campaigning for clean air.
What made you start worrying about air pollution?
After several years living in London, my husband's asthma deteriorated markedly. The consultant told him that he was living in one of the worst areas in possibly the country for an asthmatic to be in. And then I noticed a deterioration in my asthma, and I hadn't had asthma since I was a child. I then started getting concerned about the children.
Shazia set out to measure for herself the levels of nitrogen dioxide in her neighbourhood. Like the rest of London, it's not expected to meet the EU limits on that emission for 15 years.
Our results were quite shocking. All major roads that were tested came out in breach of nitrogen dioxide levels that are considered safe to human health. And they weren't just a little bit over the limit, they were significantly over the limit. And my children are inhaling that. My baby in his buggy is inhaling that level of pollution.
This primary school is just 5 minutes' walk from Shazia's home. Here, academics from Queen Mary University and King's College have been studying the impact of nitrogen dioxide on child health. They have shared their preliminary research with dispatchers.
We found that when we look at the lung development of children who've been exposed to the highest levels of pollution compared with the lowest levels of pollution, and they are developing smaller, stunted lungs. So that's a big concern. If I was a parent of a child living in East London, then I feel that this was outrageous, that my child was living in an area that was damaging their lungs in this way.
Diesel was meant to be cleaner. In fact, it is a killer. Campaigners reckon this is something we should have been told by government and the motor industry.
Were we missold diesel, misled into our diesel cars?
Yeah, I think people have been conned to some extent. People still think that diesel is the green fuel and that buying a diesel car, they're doing the right thing by the planet. The truth is, diesel is a very heavily polluting fuel. Certainly from a public health point of view, we can't have dirty diesel vehicles in our towns and cities.
Coming up, is that diesel on your drive about to crash in value?
If we suddenly see that there is a particular penalty for owning diesel, then yes, that will have a knock-on effect.
And dispatches tests which commuters are exposed to the most exhaust nasties.
Have a look at that red spike. That is nitrogen dioxide.
Tonight on Dispatches, we're investigating the truth about diesel and the damage the fuel is doing to our air quality and our health. Unlike the smogs of the past, we can't see today's pollution and what we're breathing in.
It is a chilly yet glorious winter's morning here on the outskirts of Leeds, and this is one of the main commuter roads into the city. Now, we want to find out exactly what is coming out of these exhaust pipes and going into our lungs.
In particular, we want to see who is exposed to the most nitrogen dioxide, a dangerous pollutant linked to serious health problems. Will it be drivers or those on foot, bus or bike?
Morning, everyone. How are we?
Good morning. Thanks.
Good lie in?
No.
On your way to work, are you ever thinking about the quality of the air that you breathe?
Generally not first thing in the morning. I do, especially if a bus comes around the corner and kind of changes gear and puffs out smoke. It's not very nice.
We're asking each of them to wear a backpack carrying a nitrogen dioxide monitor.
And we've got someone who's walking.
First, it's the bus passenger and pedestrian.
OK, good luck. You're on the bus, aren't you? You're on foot. Yes. I'm off for a cappuccino. See ya.
Leeds, along with Birmingham and London, is not expected to fall within the EU limit on nitrogen dioxide for at least another 15 years. Will that be bad news for our driver and cyclist?
Be respectful of those car drivers, James. I know you always are.
Because of the breeze, it's a low pollution day, but that doesn't matter for our experiment, as we're trying to measure who is exposed to the most nitrogen dioxide. The results of our test are in.
How is everyone?
Good, thank you.
So, how was everyone's commute?
A bit cold.
Not bad.
Who do you think got the biggest hit of nitrogen dioxide on their way in to work this morning?
I don't know, I think I got the most. There were quite a few traffic lights, kind of parked cars and...
And you were walking, weren't you?
Yes, I was walking.
Anybody for the car?
Logic says no.
Logic says no.
Yeah.
Have a look at that red spike. That is nitrogen dioxide in your brand new car,
wow.
Laura.
I'm pretty surprised by that.
Didn't even put the heaters on, which would have brought the air through.
So even on a low pollution day, the exposure in the car was closest to the maximum annual safe limit of 40 micrograms per cubic metre.
If you look at the averages, we've got the car highest at 37, average annual mean is 40, buses next at 30, then the walker at 23, and lowest of all, 14. You never thought it before, but on this one instance, cycling is the safest way of commuting into work. Mm.
And if everyone cycled more, then there would be less cars, which means less pollution, so people should be walking and cycling more.
Definitely.
Laura, you've sorted it.
Yeah, it's done. Yeah.
Professor Frank Kelly has carried out similar tests and found similar results.
Because when people are in cars, if they've got the windows closed and the air conditioning on, they probably think that they're actually immune from the emissions of the vehicles in front of them. And in reality, that's not the case, because the gases penetrate so easily that they will get into the cabin of the vehicle. And depending on the ventilation of that cabin, they may actually build up to much higher concentrations.
So none of us are immune from bad air. But worry not, London Mayor Boris Johnson is planning to sort out the capital's nitrogen dioxide. He wants an ultra-low emission zone that will force drivers of older diesels, you're ahead of me here, to pay an additional fee to enter the city's congestion zone. In Paris, the mayor has gone even further, saying all diesels should be banned. Dispatchers has found that some councils are already hitting diesel drivers, charging them extra to park outside their own home. And all those people who bought their cars in the belief they were doing the right thing for the environment, Boris has sympathy.
This has been a massive failure of public policy. Millions of people were told that they were doing the right thing and the clean thing and the environmentally friendly thing by buying a diesel vehicle. And they now feel very, very hacked off that suddenly they're told that their vehicles are polluting it.
If all these changes happen, that diesel on your drive could be worth a whole lot less. Parkers, the car price guide, fear the worst.
If we suddenly see that there is a lot of legal moves or government moves to actually make diesels a less attractive prospect for buyers, and actually you will start to be taxed further, or the VED bandings change, or there's a particular penalty for owning diesel, then yes, that will have a knock-on effect.
And those MPs who set up the policies that helped convince you to go out and buy a diesel car, what would they have to say for themselves?
Was the drive for diesel a massive failure of public policy?
It was right to move away from those vehicles who were pushing out CO2 emissions. Certainly the impact of that decision has been a massive problem for public health in this country. The real tragedy is after we set up the Committee on the Medical Effects of Air Pollution, and it reported back in 2010, we've had 5 years where this government has done nothing about it.
The Department for Environment, Food and Rural Affairs dispute this and told dispatches,
we've acted on the committee's findings through providing effective health advice to the public. Air quality has improved significantly in recent decades, and we are investing heavily to continue this, committing £2 billion since 2011 in green transport initiatives.
Susie bought her car because she thought it was good for air quality. But will it be as green and economical as she thinks? Officially, it returns 48.7 miles per gallon. Our results reveal that in the real world, it's well below that, at just 39.3. We also tested that rather scary emission, nitrogen dioxide, something the manufacturers aren't required to tell you about, despite the mandatory EU levels.
Your car, when we tested it, it produces nearly three times that limit.
You're kidding.
Nope.
That's shocking.
You think you've been misled?
I do, yeah. I can't believe that's been kept from the public. I'd like to know how they would feel if their child had a lung condition. Just how they would feel. You know, watching your child go through any kind of hospital treatment, it's absolutely heartbreaking. And now knowing that I may be contributing to it by driving a car that I knew nothing about any of this before now. And I think somebody should be made to deal with this properly so that everybody knows what is coming out of their cars and can make an informed decision. Particularly a car like that, that's a family car. So you've obviously bought it because you've got children who you care about. I think it's absolutely shocking.
The manufacturer of Susie's car, SEAT, told dispatchers,
we're very disappointed with the results of these tests. It is widely acknowledged that the published tests versus real-world testing can result in discrepancy. But this standardised testing does allow the consumer the opportunity to make an informed choice. We have already started to introduce new engines, which will further improve MPG, CO2 and oxides of nitrogen emissions. SEAT takes its impact on the environment very seriously.
Do you think labelling diesel cars as environmentally friendly is misleading?
No, I think the in terms of diesel engines, they do deliver advantageous fuel economy, which obviously means less emissions and less CO2 emissions. The diesel standards are getting ever tighter.
But there's still nitrogen dioxide pouring out the back of a diesel car. Whether it's better than it was 20 years ago, big deal.
There is some, and the science is emerging around air quality and the effect of air quality on human health. Now, manufacturers can only make cars which meet the regulation, and that's what they do. But there will be the expectation or the demand that vehicles put on the road meet ever tighter regulations in the real world, not just in the laboratory.
Those tighter regulations will not instantly solve our air quality problems. For a long while in America and the Far East, they've seen the future as electric. However, in the UK, diesels are still the best sellers, and that's a big deal for everyone living in a town or a city.
We all have to breathe. We all have to eat. These are the things that keep us alive. We wouldn't eat contaminated food. We know that's bad for us. But why do we breathe contaminated air? It's equally bad for us.
Diesels have cleaned up their act. There is no question about that. But as the tax incentives could be replaced by penalties for driving them in our cities, diesels may well have had their day, even if they can look as good as this.